think so. It's not your fault. Let's go.
If you're anything like me, then your first exposure to Dragon Ball Z was after school. Around the early 2000s, and you were captivated by these monk-looking guys and girls dressed in really cool robes, and in particular Goku's orange and blue, and this super, super cool haircut. And of course, the most enticing thing about it all was his ability to tap into energy levels that were completely, what's the word? You would not have guessed an ordinary looking guy. Or at least a humble-looking guy like that would have been able to tap into. But, I guess other than the fact that he was jacked, but you saw that first Kamehameha wave, and you were immediately hooked. And, the story that unfolded after you started really tapping into, which I guess I started on the Cell saga, and there we go. Yeah, I was just drawn into the initial animation and the idea of the mysticism behind it, the harnessing of energy, and of course the duality between good and evil, just became a really kind of the glue that stuck me to the entire series from then on. So as the story unfolded, it just got better and better and more archetypal, and tapped into an already penchant for the supernatural that I was inclined towards. So anyways, Dragon Ball Z for me was a huge part of my later childhood, because I actually didn't find out about it until one of my neighborhood friends told me about it. And yeah, it just always held a place near and dear to me in my heart. It's because it has so many of those timeless elements to it. So, without further ado, we're going to tap into the history behind the famous sagas that kept millions of children glued to their afternoon television sets and kept them from getting sunburned and scraped up and breathing fresh air for years. For at least a half hour every day, to their big dismay. So, Dragon Ball Z, you don't need to be a supreme Kai to know how much of an influence Dragon Ball Z had on, well, on me, but the world of anime. There's a lot more to this franchise than just fights. spiky hair, the screaming at the top of your lungs to increase your power, even though I admittedly did that plenty of times, trying to tap into my own Super Saiyan, latent Super Saiyan powers. The Saiyan tale of Goku and his friends branches back all the way to 1984 and has more twists and turns than Snake Way. With over 500 billion, oh sorry, 5 billion, 500 billion, it's probably gonna happen soon though, 5 billion in franchise sales, Dragon Ball Z is a cornerstone of Japanese animation and a cultural phenomenon. So, although I initially got into Dragon Ball Z, I of course very quickly discovered that it had a predecessor in Dragon Ball and a predecessor. And it was the predecessor to Dragon Ball Kai, Dragon Ball GT, and spawned the Dragon Ball Empire franchise, spawned 4 anime series. See, Dragon Ball Z GT, what's the, it says 5 if you count Dragon Ball Kai, but I don't know, I honestly stopped at Dragon Ball Z, so this isn't the tale of a diehard Dragon Ball Z fan, but it certainly was a significant player in my childhood. It spawned 19 movies. I honestly didn't realize it had that many movies. Over 500 chapters of manga. Over 500 chapters of manga. Nearly 100 video games. Which, that's the most. That's definitely the most, surprising number. That's so many. Multiple Universal Studio rides, all kinds of ridiculous memes, and of course, it's over 9,000. Is a landmark event in internet memes. Shenron has finally answered your wish. As you can tell, I'm tapping into an article here about Dragon Ball's history, so it's a Looper article, if you guys want to go track it down, called The Untold Truth of Dragon Ball Z. So it's going to have a bunch of corny literary attempts to, I don't know what you would call them. It's not gonna have a bunch of corny phrases in it. Nonetheless, here we go. So, you might think Goku's journey began with Akira Toriyama, the creator of Dragon Ball, with his first Dragon Ball manga chapter in 1984, the issue of Weekly Shonen Jump. But his origin actually starts way before that. Toriyama, who'd already won multiple awards for his hit comedy manga. I'm recently starting to pronounce it manga, as I realize that's more popular. So forgive me for the slip up. Dr. Slump. So Toriyama, he originally had a hit comedy here, but he wanted to just try something very, very different, a big departure from what he had already made. He turned to older folklore, in particular the 16th century novel, Journey to the West. So this was a, tapped into it. I keep saying that, I don't know why. I looked it up, Googled it. Journey to the West is a Chinese novel published during the Ming Dynasty and attributed to W. Wu. Sorry, I don't know why I started spelling it. Wu Chengen. It is one of the four great classical novels of Chinese literature. In English-speaking countries, it is called Monkey, as Arthur Wallace, Whaley's, maybe. Adaption is most commonly read. This novel is an extended account of the legendary pilgrimage of the Tang Dynasty Buddhist monk Wen Zhang, who traveled to the western regions, that is Central Asia and India, to obtain Buddhist sacred texts or sutras and returned after many trials and much suffering. Retains the broad outline of Wanzang's own account. The great Tang records on the western regions. It's funny to think of the West being India. But the Ming Dynasty novel adds elements from folktales and the author's invention, that is the Gautama Buddha, gave this task to the monk referred to as Tang Zhenzang in the novel, and provided him with three protectors who agree to help him as an atonement for their sins. These disciples are Sun Wukong, Zhu Bai, and Xia Wujing, together with a dragon prince who acts as Tang Zazeng's steed, a white horse. Journey to the West has strong roots in Chinese folk literature, Chinese mythology, Taoist and Buddhist philosophy, and the pantheon of Taoist immortals and Buddhist bodhisattvas are still reflective of some Chinese religious attitudes today. Enduringly popular, the tale is at once a comic adventure story, a humorous satire of Chinese bureaucracy, a spring of spiritual insight, and an extended allegory in which the group of pilgrims journey towards enlightenment by the power in virtue of cooperation. So, it's a 500-year-old text. Now, going back to Toriyama, there's clear analogies between Dragon Ball Saga, the Dragon Ball universe, and a lot of its characters and the original texts, or at least the popular text of Journey to the West. Toriyama's editor, in fact, Kazuhiko Torishima, explained that Journey to the West was used because it was basically free intellectual property, which in itself is actually a very popular thing to do for large profit-making companies nowadays. And if you're not sure what I'm referencing, just think of all the original Disney animated films that you grew up on, if you're from the West. And in fact, if you're not from the West, I'm genuinely curious. I'd be fascinated to know if, you know, if you're really from any non-English speaking country, I would love to hear if you guys either watched Disney movies as well, or you had your own version of, you know, animated movies or any type of entertainment that was as ubiquitous for people's childhoods as it was in the States. I mean, there's rarely anybody I've met over here, at least, that hasn't watched a surplus of Disney animations. And honestly, you might be led to believe that Disney's this big evil corporation, or at least a corporation large enough to not solicit any sympathy or perhaps respect creatively nowadays. But Walt Disney himself was actually a really intelligent guy for using all of the works, works that were not copyrighted in the intellectual domain. So it's called public domain stories when you don't have to pay royalties to anybody to use the creative, what's it called, intellectual property of it. And in fact, with a quick few taps of the keyboard, I found that a nice little list. I'll just read some of the top movies and their subsequent profits earned by Disney by using them. All of these were not original ideas. They were works that were not only not Walt Disney's, but they were old enough to, at the time, already have been in the public domain. So Alice in Wonderland, Disney a cool $1.02 billion, with a B, dollars, and that was originally from Lewis Carroll's book in 1865. Aladdin, a nice $500 million, is from a folktale, just one of the tales, in 1001 Nights, which was originally from 1706. Some other big ones are Beauty and the Beast, from G.S. Barbeau de Villeneuve's, sounds like a French name, from 1775, before we were even declared a nation. over here in the States, earned him $425 million. A Bug's Life is actually, I honestly didn't know this one. It's from Aesop's Fables. The Aesop's Fables were a collection of fables credited to the slave Aesop, who lived in ancient Greece between 620 and 564 BC. Wow. Jesus. So he's 500 years older than Jesus. Before Socrates, Plato. I didn't realize they were that old. Bug's Life gave him $360 million. And then there's a whole slew of others. Chicken Little, Christmas Carol, Fantasia, which is a score based on Bach, Tchaikovsky, Beethoven, and older classical compositions. Frozen was actually from Hans Christian Andersen's Ice Queen, and created in 1845. And of course, Hercules. John Carter was from Edgar Rice Burroughs in 1917. The Little Mermaid. Same guy as the Frozen, the Ice Queen creator. Mulan, Return to Neverland, Pinocchio, Pocahontas, Snow White, Sleeping Beauty, Tangled, the Brothers Grimm fairy tale of Rapunzel, even The Lion King was inspired from Shakespeare's Hamlet in 1603. And it apparently was from, and that was inspired from the Japanese animated series called Kimba the White Lion. Wow, so, that's too cool. So, the Journey West was used because it was basically free intellectual property. That's the whole point we were going off on there. And the Journey West, for any of you guys who might be familiar, the the famous actor Jet Li, and also the newly famous, well, relatively to me, the other famous martial artist, Donnie Yen. They both starred in movies called The Monkey King and Journey to the West. And, Jackie Chan actually was in one too. So there's been a lot of adaptations of this movie, of this fable story. And there's actually a slew, and the most recent one coming up that's looks like it's getting a lot of flack for not using actual Asians in the roles. It's called whitewashing, which is I think it's understandable. That's a whole nother ball of wax though. Some interesting stuff on whitewashing. If you care to go down that rabbit hole on YouTube, there's a lot of actually really brilliant videos about that, kind of video essays in The Matrix, and Doctor Strange, for instance, is another one. The famous bald sorcerer lady he goes to was originally Asian in the comics, I guess. What's the recent one? Ghost in the Shell, using Scarlett Johansson instead of an actual Asian lady, because it's a, you know, it's an Asian actress. You know, I mean, who doesn't like Scarlett Johansson? But I honestly did expect them to use an Asian actress. But I don't know. I guess there's two sides to that story, because although it is an adaptation from an Asian source material, at the same time, if you're arguing that person has to look a certain way in order for it to be authentic, then in essence you're kind of discriminating based on skin color and surface looks in a way that makes you seem like a, well, kind of a racist in a way. But anyway, I'm not trying to get into that. I'm just saying there could be arguments made for both sides, but I guess a reason I brought that up was because Netflix is working with some other big companies to once again recreate an adaptation of Journey to the West. So yeah, this is extremely, and it's very, you know, rightfully so. It's got a lot of, it's got a little bit of everything. It's got mystical elements. It's got a diverse range of rich, very interesting characters. It's taps into the mysticism of religion, spirituality. It feeds the our will to power, Nietzsche's famous phrase, by allowing every character in the world access to this energy source. Like when they do the spirit bomb and Goku has to ask all the inhabitants of Earth to put their hands up so that he can use their energy. That in itself is a great analogy almost of the underlying philosophy of the entire series, that really taps into a very uplifting idea that we all harness some form of the energy field in ourselves, and it's just a matter of tapping into it with enough meditation, which I confess I definitely did as a kid. I remember it's probably after Gohan was shown by Piccolo just how powerful he really was, and I loved how Goku was so confident in his own son that he had this latent dormant power that Gohan had no idea he held within himself. inspiring, I guess, is what it is. So, that I remember sitting on my bed after he'd go home defeated Cell. And I remember sitting on my bed and literally for what seemed like an eternity for a, 13-year-old kid. Probably only was about 10 minutes long, but I tried meditating and forming a chi ball between my hands using my force, and it did not work. But nonetheless, I got a lot out of this series, so. I think it's an enduring work, and of course the source material from Journey to the West is an even more pervasive cultural artifact that isn't going to go away anytime soon, just because it has all the right elements of a great enduring tale, and so does Dragon Ball. So I didn't even get to the meat of this article yet, but I wanted to give you guys a nice background so that next time we can really, really break down, delve deep into specifically Dragon Ball and its lore and its relation to the Journey to the West characters. So I'm gonna leave it there for now, and I really want to hear what kind of stories you guys were brought up on. Speaking about that Disney tangent, it would be really fascinating to know if you guys watched Disney movies in non-English Europe or Asia or India, Australia, but Africa. Let me know. I'd be really curious. I mean, and I assume South America did, just because Spanish. I feel like everything's translated into Spanish at some point, if it's big enough, and Lord knows, Disney is definitely big enough, so. Looking forward to hearing your feedback about this episode. I'm really excited about it. I loved it. It was really fun talking about it, and I love learning the relation between modern and historical events. Like me and Shenanigans were we weren't talking, I was about to say he or she. I can't tell based on your goofy profile picture, but if you listen to this, thanks, Shenanigans, for your really insightful comments about the ancient Greeks and just how their perception was so much different than ours, and how learning about that can really help us comprehend and categorize more accurately just where our values lie nowadays relative to historical ones. And it kind of just helps you know just where you are in history. And that's what I love about these stories, is that there's so much rich literature out there that it's really cool that people can recycle it and put it to good use, so it doesn't get lost, so we're not endlessly repeating the same mistakes. Because it doesn't matter how old certain things are, if there's value, there's value. You know, it might need to be restylized for a modern audience, but the core of the story is still the same. Alright, I'm gonna let you guys go now. I really hope you enjoyed this, and yeah, as always, you know, subscribe if you really loved it. I'm really grateful for all your subscriptions always. You guys really keep me going doing that. I love getting online and seeing all your likes and all your comments, and that more people have found my channel. And yeah, that what I'm doing isn't